Morning, church. As we continue in our journey of finding the best of all that we can be for the glory of God's kingdom, I found that song as almost a prayer for God's presence in my life and a prayer for God's Spirit to wash over me. And I think one of the things that I think of when I think of the Holy Spirit is he kind of gets a raw deal. You know, you have God the Father, the creator of heaven and earth and everything in it. And you have Jesus the Son who came, who taught, who died, and was rose again. And then in that same Trinity, in that same triune God, you have the Holy Spirit. But we don't hear as much about him. We don't hear and celebrate the presence of him. I mean, in the Bible lesson last week, we heard how he came and fell upon the disciples and those gathered there. And because of his presence, there was like flames darting upon their head and a loud wind rushing through the building. So loud and so obvious that people from everywhere came to see what was going on. And in that thought, then you kind of get the feel like, okay, great. Boy, that was awesome. But that was just the beginning of the third part of the Trinity. One of the blessings that we're having right now is the Java with Jesus guys. And if one of you guys want to lead Wednesday, because I can't be there, that you're more than welcome to do that. Just call everybody and keep going, because I hate to stall us when I get called away. But if someone wants to pick up and lead, please keep them going. But one of the blessings that we found in that book was what I call a really clear and definite, definitive explanation of the Holy Spirit, of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. One triune God. The Holy Spirit was described by John MacArthur, who wrote our book, the following way. And when I reflect on his definition, on his explanation, it truly makes me wanting more. More of its presence and more of its overwhelming blessing in my life. John MacArthur writes this: the Holy Spirit is the divine agent who creates, sustains, and preserves the spiritual life in those who place their trust in Jesus Christ. You and I. The Holy Spirit is not merely an influence or an impersonal power emanating from God. He is a person, the third member of the Holy Trinity, equal in every way to God the Father and God the Son. That was like refreshing for me to look on him upon that way. Among the many characteristics of the personhood that the Holy Spirit manifests are: he functions with the mind, with emotion, and with will. He loves the saints, meaning those who believe and seek Jesus Christ in their life. He communicates with them. He teaches, he guides, he comforts, and he chastises us. He can be grieved, quenched, lied to, tested, resisted, and even blasphemed. But since Pentecost, the Holy Spirit has indwelt in all believers. All of us have the Holy Spirit living within us. Amen? Hallelujah. Illuminating their understanding and application of what? Of God's Word. He fills them. He seals them. He communes with them. He fellowships with them, and he intercedes for them. He comforts them, admonishes them, sanctifies them, and enables them to resist sin and serve God. I want me some Holy Spirit, amen? I want my cup to overflow with his presence. He is not one and done, but he is eternal with us until Christ returned, as promised by Christ. I will leave you with another, an advocate, who will be with you and never leave you or forsake you until my return. God didn't ascend into heaven and live for ourselves. He blessed us. He poured upon us his Spirit, who wasn't just here for a visit, but was here to dwell within us, to make us strong enough to withstand the evil and the darkness of this world. Amen? Man, this, the, I don't know if I was just that lackadaisical in my understanding of the Spirit, but it definitely, for me, gave me a boost in the awesomeness of God, a boost in God's will for us to succeed, and His blessing for us to learn the true meaning of His Word. So the message this morning begins again in the book of Acts. We're going to start in Acts chapter 2. Dear brothers, think about this. You can be sure that the patriarch David wasn't referring to himself. For he died, he was buried, and his tomb is still here amongst us. But he was a prophet, and he knew that God had promised with an oath that one of David's own descendants would sit upon the throne. David was looking into the future and speaking of the Messiah's resurrection. He was saying that God would not leave him among the dead, nor allow his body to rot in the grave. For God raised Jesus from the dead, and we are all witnesses of this. Now he is exalted in the place of highest honor in heaven and sits at God's right hand. And the Father, as he had promised, gave him the Holy Spirit to pour out upon us. Just as you have seen here today, God's plan was always to wash us in the Spirit that would live in us. For the Lord said to my Lord, sit in this place of honor at my right hand until I humble your enemies and make them a footstool under your feet. So let everyone in Israel know for certain that God has made this Jesus. Now he said this, whom you crucified, to be both Lord and Savior. Peter's words pierced their heart. They said to him and to the other apostles, brothers, what should we do? Peter, filled with the Spirit, he said, each of you must repent of your sins and turn to God and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. Then you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. This promise is to you, to your children, and to those far away, all who have been called by the Lord our God. Then Peter continued preaching for a long time, strongly urging all the listeners, save yourself, he said, from this crooked generation. Those who believed what Peter said were baptized and added to the church that day, 3,000 in all. Now, 3,000 doesn't sound like an overwhelming number, but in that time and in that place, it would have been like a football stadium being filled to capacity. What do you do with 3,000 people who come to the Lord? Amen? You praise Him. You celebrate Him. So all the believers then devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship and to sharing in meals, including the Lord's Supper, and to prayer. And a deep sense of awe came over all of them. And the apostles performed many miracles and signs and wonders. And all the believers met together in one place and shared everything they had. Well done, church. Well done, even those in the back row. Well done. They sold their property and possessions and shared their money with those in need. They worshiped together at the temple each day, met in homes for the Lord's Supper, and shared their meals with great joy and generosity, all the while praising God and enjoying the goodwill of all people. And each day, the Lord added to their fellowship those whom were being saved. Remember what our meals were like? When we would gather downstairs and laugh and share food and delicious memories. The last one we had was sausage and pancakes. Our last meal here at Otterbein. But a new day's come. A new time to gather and fellowship, to share our love with one another is coming. For nothing can quench the will of God. I am the church. You are the church. We are the church together. Come, Holy Spirit, fill us with your presence. And make us strong to do all things that bring honor and glory to you. Now, Peter, he was filled that day with the Spirit. And it said in that passage that he preached a long time. Now, I know you're all kind of willing, like, oh, I hope Pastor John doesn't take that literally. But there's more to the story we must understand. So we're going to fast forward now to the book of Acts 4. While Peter and John were speaking to the people, they were confronted by the priests, the captain of the temple guard, and some of the Sadducees. These leaders were very disturbed that Peter and John were teaching the people that through Jesus there is a resurrection of the dead. They arrested them, and since it was already evening, they put them in jail until the morning. But many of the people who heard their message believed it. So the number of men and women who believed now totaled over 5,000. First it was 3, then it's 5. God is doing something, amen? The next day, the council of all the rulers and elders and teachers of religious law met in Jerusalem. Annas, the high priest, was there, along with Caiaphas, John, Alexander, and other relatives of the high priest. They brought the two disciples in and demanded, "By what power or whose name have you healed this man?" You know, Peter, he was going to tell them. Peter, filled with the Spirit, said, "Rulers and elders of our people, are we being questioned today because we've done a good deed for this crippled man? Do you want to know how he was healed? Let me clearly state to you all and to all the people of Israel that he was healed by the powerful name of Jesus Christ the Nazarene, the man whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead. For Jesus is the one referred to in the scriptures where it said, 'The stone that the builders rejected has now become the cornerstone.'" Whoa! The cat was out of the bag. He said it and people heard him. He overturned the wheelbarrow. He threw the tables upside down and he said, "No more. The truth is the only way this world will be saved is through whom? Through Jesus Christ our Lord, whom you killed, whom you murdered, whom you put in the grave, but whom God raised from the dead on Easter morn. And he is alive, and he is well, and he has filled you with his Holy Spirit." Amen? That is the good news, that the Holy Spirit wasn't one and done. Just didn't give everybody the power to speak in tongues one time, but he will never leave us or forsake us, not because he's just here, but because he's here. He's here. And we can't, it said, we can try to get rid of him. We can lie to him. We can cheat him. But he loves us so much that he's never going to leave us, that he's never going to forsake us. "There is salvation in no one else," Peter said. "For God has given no other name under heaven by which you must be saved." Oh, I don't think they probably liked that. That was an attack on their comfort zone. The members of the council were amazed when they saw the boldness of Peter and John. where they could see that they were just ordinary men with no special training in the Scriptures. They also recognized them as the men who had been with Jesus. But since they could see the man who had been healed standing right there amongst them, there was nothing the council could say. So they ordered Peter and John out of the council chambers and conferred amongst themselves. "What should we do with these men?" they asked. "For we can't deny that they have performed a miraculous sign, and everybody in Jerusalem knows about it. But to keep them from spreading their propaganda any further, we must warn them not to speak to anyone in Jesus' name again." I like that. "So they called the apostles back in and commanded them never again to speak in the name of Jesus." I would have loved to have been the fly on the wall. But Peter and John replied, "Do you think God wants us to obey you rather than him? We cannot stop talking about everything we have seen and have heard. I can do all things through Christ my Lord, who strengthens me. I can speak with boldness. I can love like Jesus. I can forgive like Jesus. And I can withstand the persecution of the dark world in order that others will know the truth that Jesus is alive and is living in me." Amen. When filled with the Spirit, we can do all things. So it's our time, church, to stand boldly on the promises of God's Word, to invoke and to embrace and to celebrate the presence of the Holy Spirit, so that shooting one another and hating one another and burning our buildings and houses is wrong, and the world understands that it is wrong. And in all things, forgiveness is golden. Grace is golden. The world is in desperate need of the truth. And we have been anointed. We have been filled with God's Spirit to speak and to live the truth. Remember the scripture back in Titus where Paul was telling Titus how the church must live? That's a little convicting, amen? I hope it wasn't just for me. "The elders of the church must live a blameless life." Ooh. Strike one. "They must be faithful to their wives, and their children must believe who don't have a reputation for being wild and rebellious." Swing and a miss. "The church leader is a manager of God's house, so he must live blameless. He must not be arrogant or quick-tempered." Ooh, foul ball. "He must not be a heavy drinker, violent, or dishonest with money. Rather, he must enjoy having the guests in his home. He must love what is good, and he must live wisely and be just. He must live as a devout and disciplined life. And he must have a strong belief in the trustworthiness of God's word that has been taught to him. Then they will be able to encourage one another with wholesome teaching and show those who oppose them that they are wrong." I remember long ago talking with my dad. My dad was in poor health when I decided to leave the business world and go into ministry. And he said, I can still, I think you were sitting there with me, Jenny. He said, John Howard, what do you want to do that for? You think you have it bad now in the business world. People don't treat their pastors very nice. I've seen some of that. I've heard some of that. But because of the presence of the Holy Spirit, that too can change. We can be a place where all are welcome. We are a place where God's Spirit lives within us. You want to know how I know that? Because there's a little girl who's graduating this year who asked to be a part of our graduation service. She's not a little girl. She's a beautiful young woman. She's always going to be a little girl because I've known her that long. She said, Pastor John, I'm not a member of your church, but they've always loved me. But she's going to join us. Because when she came here, she saw Jesus. When she came here, she experienced his love. So much that she longs to come back and celebrate that with us. God is good. And all the time. The video I want to leave you with this morning. It moved Michelle so much she texted me at like 6 o'clock in the morning on a Monday or Tuesday. She says, you got to watch this. This is who we have to be. Minimize that and then go to the internet. The blue circle. There it is.
I woke up in, saw a world full of trouble. Now I thought, how do we ever get so far down? And how's it ever gonna turn around? So I turned my eyes to heaven. I thought, God, why don't you do something? Well, I just couldn't bear the thought of people living in poverty, children sold into slavery. The thought disgusted me, so I shook my fist at heaven. I said, God, why don't you do something? He said, I did. Yeah. I created you. If not us, then who? Yeah.
change the world by standing still.
Well, pretty much God's word, isn't it? Go forth and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Holy Spirit. And remember this, I am with you always, even until the end of ages. We're willing to do something. If we're willing to rise from the ashes like the phoenix, join me in our closing hymn, Take My Life and Let It Be. Have a challenge. This week, when we leave this place, when we go out into the darkness, let us be a light into the world. Write down that moment in which the Spirit of Christ that dwells within us all leads us to be kind, leads us to be gentle, leads us to love the unlovable and forgive the unforgivable. Write it down. Text me, email me, call me, so that as we worship together, I'll practice anonymity, unless you'd like to stand and tell us yourself. Let us rejoice in the fact that we are of Christ's Spirit, and we can overcome. Paul wrote to the church, to the Hebrews, when he was worried about them becoming complacent. He said, "Dear friends, even though we are talking this way, we really don't believe it applies to you. For we are confident that you are meant for better things, things that come with salvation. For our God is not unjust. He will not forget how hard you have worked for him and how hard you have shown your love to him by caring for other believers, as you still do. Our great desire is that you keep on loving others as long as life lasts, in order to make certain that what you hope for will come true. Then you will not become spiritually dull or indifferent. Instead, you will follow the example of those who are going to inherit God's promises, because of their faith and their endurance. Let us be Christ's church. In his precious name. Amen."